Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mousse Hysteria by Gretchen Allen, narrated by Carrie Coello. Chapter 1. Billie Halifax eyed the large group of people in the center of the cafe. She knew the place didn't belong to her, and that there were no assigned seats, but she'd been sitting in the same spot once a week, every week, for as long as she'd been living in Sea Glass Island, Florida. She tried to rationalize her feelings as she looked around the cafe. There were a few empty tables on the outer edge of where the very loud group sat, but she didn't want to be anywhere near all that noise. She liked a quiet start to her morning. And since it was still before 7, and she'd only managed a single cup of coffee before she'd left her house, Billie settled in on a high-top chair at the counter instead. Seconds later, she'd been delivered a steaming cup of coffee.
"Rhonda coming this morning?"
Angie, the glorious caffeine deliverer, asked. "She should be here soon." Billie held on to the cup like it was her lifeline.
"You might as well bring her some coffee, too. And how about a blueberry muffin for each of us? Grilled with extra butter? You know me so well."
Billie winked and stirred a heaping spoonful of sugar into her coffee. As she did, the sleeve of her sweater rubbed against the skin on her arm. She winced and sucked in a breath, trying to will away the pain. It wasn't her first burn from the kitchen, and it certainly wouldn't be her last. But dang, did it hurt. All she could hear behind her was a chattering of voices. She pulled out a small notebook from her purse and tried to concentrate on a recipe she was finalizing for her newest food truck. The bakery truck specialized in mousse, and for the life of her, she couldn't pick a recipe for her main menu item. She'd come up with several ideas, but none of them seemed good enough for the upcoming bridal convention. Finding a way to satisfy several hundred women at once wasn't something that was going to be easy, and she was running out of time. Normally, she at least tried to be ahead of the game, but that didn't always work out in her favor. A white chocolate cupcake, filled with raspberry mousse, had been her favorite idea so far, but part of her was thinking of branching out a bit. When a bride-to-be went to her cake tasting, the baker had a variety of options for her to choose from. Billie wondered if she should try out the same thing. A mousse flight. Flight of the mousse? She laughed out loud at her terrible name ideas. After jotting down a few flavor options, she picked up her phone, seeing a missed text from her friend, Rhonda Knapp. It wasn't like Rhonda to be late to anything, so when Billie first saw the text, she'd worried something bad had happened. However, when she read the text, all she could do was groan. Rhonda was an older woman and had lived on the island for her entire life. She'd not only been Billie's grandmother's hairdresser, but also her very good friend for many years. When Adeline Lynch passed away and Billie ended up on the island, Rhonda had taken her under her wing. With a fleet of inherited food trucks, most of which were non-functional, Billie had her work cut out for her and appreciated all the help she could get. She'd experienced a lot of firsts since she'd been on the island, but today was one of the more surprising ones. Rhonda wasn't coming to breakfast. It wasn't because she was sick or had other plans. It was because she was afraid. Billie let the host at the cafe know that she'd be right back and ran out the front door to where Rhonda, no doubt, stood.
"You aren't serious,"
she balked when she spotted her friend. Rhonda was on the side of the building, leaning around to peer through the front window.
"You don't understand. That group, those people,"
Rhonda stammered, and turned away from the window, her back flat against the brick exterior.
"I know good and well you aren't scared of socializing. Why don't you want to see them?" Billie asked. "Who are they?"
"They're all hairdressers," Rhonda explained. "I somehow forgot that every year during the bridal convention, they flock to the island like a bunch of crazed maniacs."
"Is it possible you're exaggerating?"
Billie tried not to laugh at the look on Rhonda's face.
"I most certainly am not.
every hairdresser from the mainland comes here this week. They claim it's to try to help customers, but all they end up doing is poaching clients from the island. I know I'm not cutting hair anymore, but it fires me up every time I see them. And not only that, they're also the biggest gossip hounds you'll ever meet. Trust me when I say you don't want anything to do with them. First of all, Billie put her hand on Rhonda's arm. I don't plan on having anything to do with them. I picked us out 2 seats at the counter, so we don't even need to look their way. And second of all, you don't cut hair anymore. You've moved on to other things. And whatever any of those people have to say shouldn't affect you in the least. They can't take your clients anymore. And if they want to give you a hard time, we can find a way to banish them from the event entirely. Really? You think we could get away with that? Rhonda asked, suddenly perking up. Billie shook her head and laughed. Of course we aren't going to banish people, but you and I both know that the only official hair vendor is from the island. Unless these people plan on overtaking the place, I think it'll be fine. Now let's forget all that and go inside. My coffee is getting cold, and you know how I feel about soggy muffins. It was Rhonda's turn to groan. Fine, I'll go, but I'm not happy about it. The women walked inside, and Rhonda did her best to hide her face from the group in the center of the cafe. She slid onto the high-top chair with ease and didn't even turn her head in the slightest. In fact, she did her very best to cover her face. She looked more like a fugitive than the head of the community center on the island. As they ate, Billie told Rhonda about her ideas for the convention. For the first time, she wasn't nervous. She was busy and life was hectic, but she wasn't afraid to participate. Ever since she'd started her food truck business, one thing or another had gone wrong. But not this time. She had a great set of managers for her first 2 trucks, and she was raring to go. Nothing was going to stop her from succeeding. Rhonda quickly finished up her muffin and took out her phone. Sorry, I know you don't like it when I work and chat, but I wanted to check my calendar. It's going to be a busy week down at the community center, and I don't want to forget anything important. It's fine, Billie said. She had plenty of her own work to do, but she'd promised herself she was going to do some self-care before she really got started on things. In the past 4 months, she'd been through a lot. She'd moved across the country, started a taco truck, dealt with 2 murders that were much too close to home, planned and started a 2nd food truck, and was now getting ready for a large bridal convention that she was barely ready for. But life was good, and she kept telling herself that anytime she started to feel overwhelmed. A few minutes passed, and Billie saw someone headed their way. She nudged Rhonda to get her attention. I'll be done in a second, Rhonda hissed. Billie nudged her again, this time a little harder. Geez, I said I was... Rhonda's eyes went wide and her jaw dropped. Why didn't you tell me? She glared at Billie. I tried, Billie whispered, and turned in her chair to face the woman who was staring them down. Hello, she said. The woman openly ignored her and kept her gaze on Rhonda. Michelle, Rhonda said dryly. Michelle raised a brow.
You know, I said to myself, that woman looks just like my old friend, Rhonda Knapp. But when you didn't come rushing right over to say hello, I began to wonder if my eyes were playing tricks on me.
Who you calling old? Rhonda muttered, before pasting on the fakest smile Billie had ever seen.
Ah, yes, I was in a very important business meeting, and I couldn't get away. I'm so grateful you were kind enough to come over.
Billie put on her actress cap and nodded wildly.
I do hope the two of you find time to catch up, but right now, Miss Rhonda, we have work to do. Can you all take care of this reunion later?
Michelle pursed her lips and slowly turned her head toward Billie.
My, my, aren't you something? Who are you again? That's Billie Halifax, CEO of Halifax Creations,
Rhonda answered for her, and left Billie feeling surprised at the official title.
CEO. That explains it. Those types are always the same.
Michelle shook her head and frowned.
Anywho, Rhonda, I just wanted to say hello and make sure you were keeping yourself safe.
Rhonda opened her mouth to reply, but seemed unsure.
Safe? Are you threatening me?
Michelle cackled.
You've always been such a hoot. Of course I'm not threatening you. I'm talking about the FSS.
What's that? Rhonda asked. Billie began to lose interest. She assumed FSS was a hairdresser term, and Michelle was going to start going on about some blow dryer that got too hot and was going off the market for being unsafe. Michelle gasped.
The four-something strangler, dear! You haven't heard?
Rhonda scoffed.
Heard what? It's all over the community. I mean, what did you expect? You're hosting a bridal convention. That's the prime place for someone like him to be.
Billie looked back and forth between the two for a moment and cleared her throat. What exactly is the four-something strangler?
Just as it sounds, young lady. There is a man who lurks around, hoping to find an unassuming bride. He lures her into his life, strangles her, and leaves her body behind with the four-somethings. You know, the things the bride gets before a wedding. It's all over the news.
Rhonda held up a hand.
Now you just hold on for a minute, Michelle. It's not all over the news. It happened 3 times in the Midwest, and that's what they named the killer. It's all over the news out there, but not here. And the only reason I know that is because my sister lives there. What proof do you have that he's on the island? Again, dear, it's because of your convention. Where else would someone called the four-something strangler be?
Michelle nearly smiled as she said the words. You seem proud of that statement of yours, Billie said. What else do you know?
Think she knows, you mean.
Rhonda rolled her eyes.
Fine. It might not be all over the news here, but it's the hot goss, as the kids call it. That killer isn't far.
Michelle stood her ground.
When was the last time you knew me to be wrong?
Rhonda nearly choked.
Michelle, you might be right about a lot of things, but this is a serious story you're starting. Where's the proof? Everyone who is someone knows. I heard there was even a private eye hired to look for the guy,
Michelle said with a shrug.
Actually, I'm shocked your CEO here isn't fully aware of what's going on.
Billie, not having said much, finally spoke up. What on earth is a private eye going to do that the police can't?
I mean, how do you know the killer is a man? What are the four-somethings they leave? Why would they choose Sea Glass Island of all places to go?
It's not like bridal conventions are all that common this time of year. Am I supposed to believe that some killer is going online to search for faraway locations so he can hunt down his next victim?
I've got to be going, Michelle said. I didn't realize your business associate was so inquisitive.
She turned up her nose and stalked off back toward her group.
Did she just call me nosy?
Billie asked, wide-eyed and bothered. Rhonda laughed.
You just made an enemy for life. I'm never leaving your side again, because I bet Michelle is going to run as far away as possible anytime she sees you. I knew introducing you as a CEO would make her uncomfortable, and one thing that woman can't stand is when people question her. She believes she's a top-tier investigator when it comes to the rumor mill.
Well, Billie folded her arms and watched Michelle as she whispered to her friends.
She's got another thing coming.
Chapter 2. Billie rested her head against the wooden lounge chair and closed her eyes. Water gently lapped against the shore and soothed her nerves as she listened. A cool breeze blew off the gulf and over her. The temperature might still be warm, but being on the water made it feel much cooler. She pulled her hands inside the sleeves of her oversized hooded sweatshirt and exhaled slowly. Normally, her weekly breakfast meetings with Rhonda served as a calm way to start her day, but that hadn't been the case this time around. She could hear the crunch of footsteps in the sand behind her. Billie pinched her eyes closed a little harder.
She had a clear picture in her mind of who it was. "Hello, Asher," she said, before he had a chance to say anything.
"What are you doing out here? Aren't you supposed to be getting ready for the convention with your new truck manager?"
"I appreciate that you want to be my human calendar, but I'm doing just fine," Billy said, instantly feeling guilty for how snappy she'd sounded. Months after she had arrived on the beautiful island off the west coast of Florida, the commissary kitchen manager remained a pain in her rear end. But with each day that passed, she couldn't help but enjoy their banter.
"Doing just fine, huh? How's that arm of yours treating you?"
he asked as he sat down in the chair next to her. A couple days before, Billy had been frying a taco egg roll for her food truck, Taco the Town, and her arm was splattered pretty badly by the hot oil. She knew she needed to get it checked out, but today wasn't the day for that. She hadn't even told Rhonda what happened, and after the eventful breakfast with her an hour before, she wasn't all that interested in doing anything but sitting on the beach and attempting to relax until seconds before she had to be in the kitchen. It wasn't even 9 in the morning, and she was already feeling the stress of the day taking over. "I'm fine."
"It's not going to get any better sitting out here on the beach," Asher challenged.
Like the struggles of running a food truck business, Asher Scanlon had come to grow on her in some ways, but right now she just wanted him out of her space.
"I didn't come out here to find a magic cure," she said. "I just wanted a few minutes to relax."
"Your workday hasn't even started yet, and you already need a break?"
Asher huffed.
"I've already reorganized the pantry, made breakfast, and had a meeting with a potential new client for the kitchen."
"Good for you. I've been ignoring the pain in my arm, had my weekly meeting with Rhonda, found out about a serial killer who has apparently decided that our island is the best place for him to be, and now I'm dealing with you. Who wins this game?"
"I don't even know where to begin with any of that,"
Asher said, running his hands through his thick black hair.
"No kidding."
"First of all, you need to put on your big girl pants and drive your car onto the mainland to see a doctor,"
he said flatly.
"Really? That's where you go first."
Billy growled her annoyance.
"Stop talking about my burn."
She covered her head with her good arm, closed her eyes, and sighed. The biggest problem, other than Asher, was in her refusal to drive her car across the bridge connecting Sea Glass Island with the Florida mainland. After her late grandmother's attorney called her out of the blue to offer her the strange situation she now found herself in, Billy had made just one whirlwind visit to the island to view the commissary kitchen and the dilapidated fleet of food trucks set to be revived one at a time until the entire fleet was up and running. On her first visit, she had the luxury of using a rideshare service to shuttle her across the bridge. The trip was short and sweet. She hadn't even met Asher until her second visit, when she had officially moved to the island. Since then, Billy had left the island only a handful of times, and always in a friend's car or calling upon a rideshare app on her phone. She'd only made it onto the island with her car because she'd called a tow truck to drive her there and pull her car behind it. Call it a mental block, call it insanity, but Billy could not force herself to drive over the long road. The very thought of it caused her to feel closed in and short of breath. The worst part was that the latest festival the island was hosting, the bridal convention, had made finding a ride on and off the island nearly impossible. If she was going to find a doctor to help her, she was going to have to drive herself. And that just wasn't going to happen.
"Fine. But what's this about a serial killer being here? I haven't heard anything about that."
Asher sat up tall and leaned into her, suddenly more interested in their conversation. Billy sighed again and opened her eyes. She told him about what that woman Michelle had said and waited for him to come back with a smart-aleck reply.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.